The final technique that we will look at in this lecture is it's called candidate key detection. And we will look at how to do this at scale with so-called hyperlocklock sketches. So what is key detection? What do we look at there? So that's again a technique for categorical data, I think strings mostly, or identifiers. And the observation is that in some cases, the frequency of values, like how often a certain value occurs in an attribute, is more important than the actual values themselves. And that's especially the case for categorical data attributes, where, as we already said, the values have no ordering. And you also cannot really compute a distance between between these numbers. The paper talks about the species code in a data set of animal sightings, but I don't think this example is very intuitive. I would suggest that you think about the case where you know there should be some ID column in the data, but maybe you don't have the names of these columns. And let's say you get CSV files or Excel sheets, and you are looking at the columns and you try and decide which one is the column is a column that identifies each record. And then you would look at the values and you would basically look at the frequency. And that's exactly the application of the techniques that we will talk about. So what we want to discover are so-called candidate keys. And a key is an attribute or a combination of attributes in a data set that uniquely identifies a tuple. So if you've used relational databases, you might know that very often you define a primary key for a table. That's exactly the thing that we're looking for. And very often we use some human generated primary keys. So let's say in data about people in the US, the social security number of people is in a sense a primary key for that person, or in the Netherlands, the BSN is a primary key for that person. So that that uniquely identifies us. So if we were to look at some database about people and there's a column that looks like it has BSNs, then that would be such a candidate key. Now, if the data is clean, then every value of the candidate key should only occur once, because it needs to uniquely identify a tuple. Like every person has only one BSN, and no two persons have the same BSN. So in that case, the number of distinct values in a certain attribute of the data equals the number of tuples or of records of the data. There's as many keys as we have data entries. Now, the problem is that if we have dirty data, both of these conditions can be violated. And the question then becomes, how can we do this key detection on dirty data? So here we have an example on the right side. Let's say there is a column called item ID for our data. And we think that it's a key column. So we think that it identifies our records. But the problem is there's three strange entries in there, 000, which are repeated. So the question is this actually a key column and it's just dirty, or is it some kind of other column? And again, the techniques proposed in the paper from Hellerstein here are based on heuristics. So Hellerstein proposes two different heuristics to do some kind of educated guess whether this is a key column or not. The first heuristic is the so-called unique row ratio. So we look at the ratio of distinct values of an attribute to the number of tuples. And again, in clean data, this should be one. And for this heuristic, we would say that an attribute is a potential key if this heuristic is somewhat close to one. Now that's I think the most straightforward way to do key detection. But the problem here is that you can have what's called frequency outliers. You can have small numbers of values with a very, very high frequency, that are actually not real values, that are just caused by user interfaces that force users to invent some dummy values, like a column that consists completely of zeros, or people just put in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we see that in our example. So we have this 0, 0, 0 value, which has a very high frequency, but is probably something like this. And in real world data, this could happen. So let's say you move to a country and you asked for your social security number or BSN, but you don't have it yet, but you still but you already have to enter some data into some human resources management system. So maybe you start to invent some BSN just to be able to proceed. A heuristic that's better suited for this task is the so-called unique value ratio. So here we look at the ratio of unique values to the number of distinct values. So the number of distinct values is simply the size of the set of all values that we see. But here we only look at the unique values. So we only look at, we only compare that to unique values. And the unique values are all values that occur only once. And again, an attribute is a potential key if the heuristic is close to one. But this heuristic is more robust against frequency outliers because we ignore values that occur more than once independently of how often they occur. And both of these techniques are actually used. And for this error identification technique, we look at a technical property. So the problem is, if we want to compute this, then in many cases, we actually have very high memory requirements during the computation. Because the problem is, if we want to exactly count the frequencies of all the values of an attribute, then we need memory linear in the number of distinct elements. So what we have to do is we have to create a hash table, or in Python, you would use a dictionary. With the values and the count. So in this hash table, whenever we see a value, we put it as key in this hash table, and then we simply count how often we see this. And this gives us this frequency statistics, and from these frequency statistics, we could then compute the heuristics from the previous slide and then make an educated guess. Now, obviously, this doesn't scale to large data sets or unbounded data sets like streams. Because of the growth of the memory. And in the following, we will look at, I think, a very interesting data structure, the so-called hyperlog-log sketch, which has been designed to address exactly this problem. So it's a so-called sketch data structure. And sketch data structures are approximations of other data structures that work with a very small, and in many cases even a fixed amount of memory. And there are many sketches for all kinds of different problems. And this hyperlog-log sketch uses randomization to approximate the cardinality of a multiset. So we have a set of values or a stream of values, and we want to know approximately how many distinct values are in this set. And the basic idea in this hyperlog-log sketch is to use hashing. So we have a stream of, let's say, strings. So here we have hello world, hello Alice world. And then we need a hash function that we apply to every element to be counted. And our hash function is deterministic. So for a given input, it will always produce the same output. But it should produce output that are uniformly, that are distributed uniformly at random. So in some sense, this hash function produces a random number for each input, but always the same number for the same input. And then the trick in hyperlog-log is that we look at the number of leading zeros of the hash value, and the hash value is a number, but we can look at its bit representation. And we keep track of the maximum number of leading zeros. So in the example, this would be 2 because we have this hash value for Alice that has two zeros. And then the intuition is that hash values with more leading zeros are less likely to occur. And in that sense, they indicate a larger cardinality. And a simple technique would be that if we see that a bit pattern of O to the power of Q minus 1 and then a 1 at the beginning of a hash value, then we estimate the size of the multiset as 2 to the power of Q. So that's the main idea of the algorithm. In practice, there's a couple of optimizations that are implemented. So first of all, the algorithm applies several techniques from statistics to reduce the variability of these measurements. So what we do is we divide our input stream into m substreams. And we always store the certain number p of bits. And then we have an array of registers. And in each of these registers, we store this maximum number of leading zeros that we've seen in that part of the stream. And the final estimate uses all these registers and then applies what's called a bias-corrected harmonic means on the estimations on these substreams to estimate this cardinality. If you're interested in the detail, you can take a look at the paper that we linked, but I think it's mostly it's most important to understand the basic idea that we described on the first page. So we use this number, the number of leading zeros of the hash value, to get some estimate of the cardinality. The interesting thing about this hyperlog-log sketch is that it's extremely widely used and extremely powerful in practice. So it has really, really low memory requirement. So it's, for example, integrated in the Spark SQL implementation, where you can use it to do an approximate count distinct. And if you look into the implementation, then they use less than 3.5 kilobytes for the registers. And that already allows them to work with billions of elements. So in some sense, you can count really, really large sets with a very small amount of memory. Another advantage of this algorithm is that it's really easy to parallelize, because we have these registers that store the maximum number of leading zeros that we see in some part of the data. And we can compute these registers and counts on different parts of a stream in parallel. And then we can very easily merge them, because for each register, we just need to take the maximum of the number of leading zeros. And the powerful thing here is that this allows us to run cardinality estimation even on multiple columns of a data set with a single scan. Because if we were to compute this exact, let's say with a system like MapReduce, then we actually would need to group by the value, because we need to count how often we see it, like in our word count example. But the nice thing about hyperlog-log is it's only the sketch data structure, and you only need to compute these hashes and update the registers. So you can do this by just reading the data from the beginning to the end in a single scan. There's also, I think I mentioned this in the first lecture, so I worked on a scalable data validation library called DQ that's part of some of the offerings of Amazon Web Services. And there we also have key detection integrated, and we also base it on this hyperlog-log sketch. And that closes the identification techniques that we looked at in this lecture.